Peace and blessings. This is Queenie Fama. I am the Truth Terrorist. And as you could tell by the title, it's time to get back to the basics of consciousness. And what you hear in the background is they're installing a new furnace into my joint. So please excuse a little minor background noise. When I was coming of age, I had a clear understanding of consciousness. I became a race woman, but never gave excuses for the behaviors within the race, especially of those who supposedly knew better. And this went as far as even when I was in religion, how I would hold those who were in the religion accountable for their behavior, accountable for what they said that they believed in. Now, as I began to understand how the system of patriarchy and white supremacy worked, I clearly understood with the help of my teachers that it was simply a change of our collective minds that would initiate an immediate change to our conditions. Until the collective got it, though, it would be those who came into the arena of consciousness who would have to be the example to those of the collective as to how a behavioral and value change could be beneficial to the whole. The problem is that the collective now looks at the so-called conscious and they see no difference from their own behavior and value with those who erroneously call themselves conscious, or those who we assume to be conscious based on the things that they talk about. Now, my conversion was like that scripture in the Bible that spoke of doing away with childish things. And the first childish thing was to hate how I looked as a black girl because I was not taught that I was beautiful or even pretty for that matter because I was dark skinned and had nappy hair. I had full lips and a broad nose. That was not celebrated when I was younger, and I used other attributes, you know, like my mind, my brain, to raise my esteem for myself. Another area that was childish, you know, for me was material things and my obsession with those things and my obsession for spending far more money on items than necessary simply because it was the going thing to do and everybody was, you know, wearing this particular designer brand and so forth and so on. I also had a fascination for expensive designer purses and shoes. I liked really pretty cars, fast cars and Cadillacs and, you know, those kind of, back then we loved deuce and a quarters. You know, back then it was deuce and a quarters, Cadillacs, you know, and generally all that came with that kind of stuff. And I had to reassess my mentality as I came into a clear understanding of how these systems of patriarchy and white supremacy actually worked. I realized that it didn't take all that to feel good about myself, nor did I have to spend all my damn money to look good. Now, when one becomes conscious, you literally have a transformation in your life. It's kind of similar to the religious conversions that people go through initially when they first find Jesus or Muhammad or Islam or, you know, something to that nature. And once you truly become conscious, there is no turning back, no relapses, if you will, no excuses for doing things that you learned were not good for yourself or for the race as a whole. As an example, I changed how I wore my hair not because I became aware of how the chemicals were bad for me. That was revealed to me later on, decades later. But because I became conscious of the mentality behind desiring straight hair, the hidden desire for straight hair. In the 60s, it became popular after a while to wear an afro when the consciousness of hairstyle really started in letting our hair go natural, which was in the 50s. The afro as a fad was the death of that consciousness overall, in a sense, in my opinion. It became a fad, and today the afro has been relegated to part of the costume when we want to go retro or to some kind of 60s set. I still wear it for nostalgic purposes in its purest sense before the fad, which was part of our Black Power uniform along with the dashiki. Today, I see people, men and women, who have at one time changed their hair based on that awareness, or, you know, maybe they weren't so aware but was only doing what was popular. But they reverted right back to permanently straightening their hair, which tells me that the desire for it, and I say permanently straightening their hair, that tells me that the desire for it is still there, because it is still what is most popular in the society. It is the most acceptable hair in the society. So in our so-called consciousness, we have not developed the discipline to continually go against the grain of a societal norm that is totally against who we are as African people and how we look as African people. There are also people who wear the clothing style of African people only for costume, not as a cultural way of dress as was popular as recent as the 80s. Again, consciousness is not seasonal. I mean, this is infectious as we look at the heads and bodies of even the women and men on the continent as well. But I digressed a bit just to use that as an example of how we tend to do what is fashionable or popular rather than being conscious of the principles behind our change in our behavior and the way that we think. Now, we have for the most part became disingenuous. You know, not straightforward, not candid or frank, insincere, slyly deceptive, or misleading. We're also duplicitous, which is marked by deliberate deceptiveness. Some of us are, especially by pretending one set of feelings and acting under the influence of others. And lastly, we are outright hypocrites. And you know, hypocrites are people who put on a false appearance of virtue or acts in contradiction to our stated beliefs or feelings. When it comes to consciousness, this is definitely what has to be called out, and this is definitely what needs to be straightened out. And irregardless as the people calling us judgmental, or whether people are, you know, just being, totally negative of the fact that there are some of us who are holding us to a higher standard, we have to take those licks and keep it moving, okay? Because at some point, when we start stepping out there on that conscious plank, we got to be real about what we say we are about. And those of us who are pretending, you must be called out. That's just the bottom line, because we have a collective that are watching what we do, watching what we say. It's, you know, just as we watch the religious community, there are people who are watching the conscious community. Those of us who are truly conscious are now being lumped in with the so-called conscious. And I am finding those who refrain from the label to be more conscious than those who say that they are conscious. We must draw the line in the sand and say enough pretension is enough. If we don't check ourselves and our consciousness, if we resort to excuses of only being human as an excuse enough to disregard anything we say we believe in, then I will gladly give up being identified as conscious and keep it moving. But, you know, the whole idea, the entire idea of identity is to connect with those who share your morality, your values, and ways of thinking and behavior. So, you know, losing that will lose the connection to the truly conscious, in my opinion. But I refuse to be confused with the unfaithful initiates of consciousness. For me, the bottom line is this, as I've observed, you know, over the years, and the past incidents have really, really brought this to the forefront to me, you know, as I listened and read, you know, what people said, in regard to a situation that just transpired, this is the bottom line for me. The bottom line is this, is that we have justified our principles of what it means to be conscious. I think some of us really don't have a clue as to what consciousness truly and really is. I think for the matter that we clearly confuse consciousness with, you know, like how we wear our hair. If we decide to be a vegan, you know, we're conscious of our diet, we're conscious of our, you know, changing our hairstyle, or, you know, we're, some of us are conscious of, you know, the clothes. But there's a package in consciousness. It's not just how you look, it's what you do, it's how you live your life. We've also have justified our fascination in this sexual revolution without accounting for the consequences of that activity, like unwanted pregnancy, disease, broken hearts, broken homes, disappointment, all of those things that go along with that. We've justified it through things like sex magic or tantra sex, just so we can have the opportunity to indulge ourselves in these desires with no restraint. And I think that is something that really, really needs to be looked at, because that in itself is part of the current cultural value that we have to assess, okay, as conscious people, or those who are on the road to consciousness, who I call the conscious initiates, okay? We have justified our love for money. I mean, we'll do anything for money and justify that shit. Okay, but there's a line to be drawn as to what the conscience will do, including selling out your own brother and sister, cheating your own brother and sister, or anyone for that matter, because consciousness just doesn't have to do with, you know, mistreating your own kind. It's humanity. You have to live up to a higher standard of humanity once you become conscious. So we've justified this love of money in the fact that we'll do anything for it. Okay, and we aspire for things that are sometimes not even necessary in our lives, but simply some kind of status symbol. Okay, and I also want to say that we've even justified calling, especially black people, we justify calling ourselves nigga in America. And they've even reached back into history and pulled out a word that sounded like it, that meant something else, and correlated that word with the word nigga in America. But you know and I know that a nigga is a nigga in America, okay? So the question that I have for each and everyone listening to this video is, when are we going to stand on the principles of consciousness? These principles are rooted in the seven virtues or principles of Ma'at. And if you follow along with me, we will go through those seven principles. Okay, we're going to take this into part two, because part one is going over the time allotted by YouTube. So I'm going to create the part two so that we could go into the principles or virtues of Ma'at, so that we can reassociate ourselves or acquaint ourselves, for many of us, with these virtues or principles. So please go to part two so that we can continue our conversation on the subject. It is time to get back to the basics of consciousness. I'll see you on the other side.